Welcome to Retro Crisis. In today's episode, we're doing something a little bit different. I've got my good friend Celia here joining me.
Hi, I'm so glad to join you. I'm very excited.
With Celia and myself, we talk about movies all the time. And we thought, you know what, why not record one of our conversations?
Absolutely. I think we've got a lot to say, and especially on this film.
So in today's episode, we're going to be discussing 1979 science fiction horror classic Alien, directed by Ridley Scott.
Well,
I don't think this was his first film, but it was one of his first kind of major films.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like Alien is such a classic, but I guess there's probably a debate about whether it's horror or if it's just purely sci-fi, but it's, you know, scary.
I think the first one is also a horror film because it's like, I've seen the subsequent Alien films and they do go more into kind of like science fiction territory. Whereas I think the first one is sci-fi. I think the first one is a horror slasher movie dressed up like a science fiction movie.
I was just going to say that because if you took the alien out of this and you put a serial killer in it, it's basically Halloween or Friday the 13th or like any of the other films from this era where everybody gets picked off.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, why don't we start with what did you think? Because I feel like I always start what I think.
I think Alien. So I've seen it before, but it's been a while. It's crazy because watching it again in preparation for this episode, I just forgot so much of this film, and I feel like I picked up much more detail this time around. But I think Alien is, I mean, dare I say it, it's one of an elite group of films for me, where I think it's near perfect. Like, it just, I mean, I don't know how many people would agree. I mean, I know a lot of folks like this movie and consider it a classic, but in my book, it's near perfect, where the acting for me is just spot on. It's very kind of realistic. The story is simple. You don't even need to speak English to understand it, but yet there's a kind of this subtle sophistication that I can't quite describe about the film. But even just visually, it just looks perfect. There's something about the science fictioniness of this film where it, like, the inside of the ship and the equipment, even though it's all like from the late 70s or whatever, there's something about it makes it look real. And like, it doesn't look like it's, even though it's probably filmed on a set, the environments look real. I really bought into it and believed it, and just everything. I'm going to use a word I don't think I ever use to describe the visuals of a movie, but I find the visuals of this, of Alien, to be sumptuous.
And you, I don't even know what's so right. I hope you have that in your notes.
Oh, I didn't even write that. That was all off the top of my head. What did you think?
I totally agree. I mean, I feel like I'm not the biggest sci-fi fan, and it takes quite a lot for me to be really invested in a sci-fi film. But I've seen this film I've seen this film a lot for various reasons, and I can never get over how good it looks, how fun it is to watch in terms of, like, obviously they're all being killed off one by one and all that's happening, but it is a joy to watch this film.
Yeah.
And I think part of it is, I found myself getting a little bit annoyed, and it was nothing to do with this film. It was the fact that in 1979, they had created a fully believable sci-fi spaceship world with an alien, with, you know, a crew, and with all the things that go into those kind of films. And you watch things today who have everything at their fingertips, and it just, like, CGI, and it just looks terrible. It just looks awful. And it looks like they're on a green screen. And this did not feel like that. And it just makes me annoyed that people, like the production companies that put these new films together, don't realize that that's not what we want. What we want is real. We want props and set and depth and all of this stuff that makes the Alien film so good.
Yeah. I think, I mean, I haven't given this much thought, but I think back then, because they had to design all the monsters and design all the sets and physically build them, and a lot of the effects had to be done in camera, that there was no computer for them to render this stuff out in or whatever. I think they were kind of forced to maybe be a bit more precise about what they wanted and what they didn't want. So there's probably a lot more planning up front. And I'm guessing today, because of all the computer graphics and films, I don't know, I think studios and whatnot put a lot of pressure on computer artists.
And they
make last minute changes, and then there's not enough budget or time for computer artists to, you know, make good visuals, mm-hmm. which then end up making them just look really rushed and really cheap. But I totally agree with you in terms of this film, despite being like, I don't know, almost 50 years old or whatever, still looks, gosh, 50, no, it's not 50 years old, is it 45 years old or whatever? Oh, I can't even count. I don't even know how.
Yeah, well, 74 was 50 years ago, so yeah.
Oh gosh, yeah, so.
A long old time ago.
Yeah, yeah, and this looks better than most stuff from the last 20 something years, easily.
Like the scene near the beginning where it does that long shot of the spaceship from the outside, and you get time to like drink it in, you know,
when the movie starts,
and you're like watching the spaceship, and you just think, like, this looks incredible. It doesn't look fake. It doesn't look like a prop. Yeah. It looks. And even I love the bit where they go onto the planet and he like goes down into that cavern where all the eggs are. Yeah. It's just like a massive space, and you can feel the emptiness in it, like the death that's there.
Yeah.
And it's just like, I mean, it's incredible.
In preparation for this episode, I watched Alien on a computer screen. Mm. So not even on a big TV or anything, but the bit that made my jaw hit the ground was when they, I can't remember which character it was. So when they go into that cavern or that room, when they got the alien sitting in the middle of the room, the dead alien, and then the camera just pulls back and back and back, just revealing this huge space. And I'm just thinking, like, how on earth did they build it? Is it like a painting, like a matte painting or something?
Yeah.
It just looked incredible. Just the colors and everything about it just looks so realistic.
And I think it's worth a watch just for that, and also just to kind of reflect on how long it's been and how it still holds up. Absolutely. I mean, obviously there's always things that we can notice are, you know, not as good as we could do now, but it almost adds to the overall feel of the film, I think. And I think one of the bits that I thought was really well done, but it was obviously a bit gimmicky in a sense, was Ash's death, you know, the robot. They do this really cool thing where his head comes off, basically, and it's sitting on the floor. And the bits where you can see the bottom of his head, it's clearly a prosthetic. But when he's talking, he's obviously under the ground with his head sticking out of the top of the ground. And they've made it look like, because it's obviously really him. But it looks so realistic. Like, you can obviously see what they've done, but it's incredible watching it, because you're like, this is really cool. I totally believe that.
Yeah, I think a lot of the Nostromo, I think, so the internals of their ship that they're on, is like, obviously it's a set on a studio, and I think it's an elevated set, so they could get underneath it and do like the chest bursting scenes, and obviously Ash, you know, when his head is talking. But there's something about the way it's lit, the way it's shot, it just looks so real. Like the sets looked so believably real and dim, and sometimes with some sets or some shows, when they film them, the camera will always be on one side of the set.
Mm.
So it makes you think maybe one half of the set is just an open exposed wall.
Yeah.
So the camera's a good point. But with this film, it just felt like that wasn't the case. Like they could have picked up the camera and shot from any angle, and it would have just
been
one contiguous kind of room or something. So.
And I like the depth and difference between the rooms, you know? So it wasn't just like one spaceship that was all, you could tell where they were depending on what, you know, were they under in the kind of bunker areas where it was a lot darker and there was steam and there was heat and all this stuff. And then you go up to their living spaces, which are lighter. And, you know, I really liked the beginning scene where they all wake up, and I did make a note of this. They were smoking on the spaceship.
Yeah, they were. Yeah,
because they'd been in this cryo sleep for however many years, and they were having their first meal of whatever space food they had, and they were just all smoking and laughing and chatting together. And you just really felt the atmosphere of all of those characters really being in that space, and like they're all really cool and like chill, you know. And it's
Kane just was smoking throughout the entire first half of the film.
Which is crazy, because it's an airtight ship. Where does it go? I literally made a note where I was like, they're smoking on the spaceship?
Well, this is set like in, oh gosh, like 2030 something, or so. Oh my God, probably have some kind of, was it
If it's 2030, that's really depressing because that's not that long in the future.
Oh, I thought when they're talking to Mother on the computer monitors, I thought the year was like 2030, something like 2037 or something like that. I could be totally wrong though, but
It's like 10 years away.
I loved how it is. I loved how even though we know the whole legacy of the Alien films, and we know that Sigourney Weaver's Ripley character is like the hero of like all the Alien movies or whatever, I loved how with this film she's not like a big character. In the first two acts of the film, she's not like a big character. She's just one of the crew, and arguably she. I mean, I think so. I know Yaphet Kotto, who plays what's his character's name in here? Parker. I think he was a name prior to this. Like he was a known actor, but I think people like Ian Holm and John Hurt, I think they might have still been quite early on in their careers where they might
because they were quite young. Like John Hurt looked really young.
Yeah, so I think they were probably still in their early stages. So yeah, you didn't really know who, or the way it's shot, you don't know who the main character is. Like it could be any one of them. And I love how as the story's progressing, and Ian Holmes' character Ash, he starts doing all these suspicious things, and Sigourney Weaver's she's the only person calling him out on it.
Yeah.
Or like, and then I think that's how she kind of becomes the main character, because she's the only one who wants to quarantine them. Not let them in the ship because they've got the alien life form on them. She's the only one who's adhering to all the rules, and she's the only one consistently calling Ash out on his breaking of the rules. And I think that's how she kind of elevates herself out of that facelessness in the group and becomes like the hero, kind of almost. So she kind of earns that position rather than just being the hero because she's like the pretty girl on the ship or whatever. Yeah,
or that it was predestined to be that way.
Yeah.
I mean, if they just listened to her, they would have been fine. Keep them in the airlock. That's what you're supposed to do. But obviously ulterior motives at play. But I think I agree. I liked her being the hero in this. And I think because I studied this at uni, I couldn't find the essay that I wrote back in the day.
I wanted to know about it. Yeah.
I know. But I do remember what it was about, which was that it was kind of gender bending the idea of like the hero and the damsel in distress. So like she is not the damsel in distress. She's absolutely the hero. She's the one that's got her head screwed on. She's the one that's like really thinking things through. And a lot of the other characters, especially the men, are hot-headed, easy to like be manipulated, you know, don't make good decisions, make rash decisions that end up with them being dead, which is what usually the women in a lot of horror films end up, or slasher films especially, end up being. They make the wrong decision, they scream and they run in the wrong direction, they get killed. You know, it's like, oh, stupid women. But in this, it's like the opposite. She is absolutely the one who ends up. And I think what I like about her character is that she ends up surviving due to her own grit. Like she just carries on. I think at one point I would have been just like, take me. Like, I don't care anymore. But she really does. She is the hero for herself. And, you know, they don't dress her up as being overly beautiful, or as in, I'm putting that in air quotes, of like she hasn't got makeup on and, you know, she's really sweaty and you can see that she's that is not her character. Her character is just to fight desperately and be very clever about it.
It's good that she's not like glammed up or anything, because they've just made her look just very realistic and natural. And you know, they've been on this ship for god knows how many years, and she, you know, she's probably not gonna make herself look glamorous every day or whatever. I mean,
no,
they all just look very natural and realistic
and normal. But I mean, the one thing I was thinking, I didn't want to get too like if you've been in cryo sleep for, I don't know, 6 years, you would have armpit hair. You'd have leg hair. Where did that disappear to? I would have much preferred it if it was just how it would actually look. And the other thing that really annoyed me is I think I had like a mental block, because in my head, the scene at the end where she thinks she's getting out and she's wearing that vest and those really small, underwear, where I'm like, someone's going to pop
the
out.
Tiny unders,
I always thought those were boxers. In my head, I thought they were male boxer briefs, and I thought it was really cool because I was like, she's like, you know, proper taking on this masculine. And then I watched it back and I was like, they're not. They're these tiny little women pants. I was like, oh, that's really disappointing.
Barely staying on her.
I know. I mean, she had crack on show and everything. I was like, but I guess it wasn't sexy. I don't think it was trying to be sexy, but it was kind of disappointing because that wasn't how I pictured it. I'd pictured her as like really masculine and just cool, you know? And yeah, that wasn't very cool.
I heard something, so I don't know how accurate or true this is. And there is a articles on Google that I found to kind of corroborate this. So, but yeah, I don't know if it's accurate, but I heard that back in whenever this film was shot, that with Sigourney, when she's wearing those short shorts, they were, you like her pubes were on show or like creeping out the sides or the top of that. And I think they felt the studio would have felt that audiences aren't ready for this kind of thing. So they had an artist go in and literally paint them out frame by frame. Yeah. And apparently now there's some kind of I'm absolutely
bring back
butchering
the pubes
this
campaign.
Yeah, I think they're using AI to bring them back. And I think the artist who originally painted them out has something to say about it or something. But
I mean, I would have preferred that. Maybe it's because I live in today's world and I think that's quite cool. I get it, I suppose, but part of me is like, her character was so outside of the pigeonhole that women are often put into. And women do have bushes. And especially if you've been, like, this is what I'm saying about armpit hair. You know, if you're going to be on a spaceship for that long, you can have armpit hair. Yeah. But I suppose it is still a film, and it was 1979. So,
yeah,
but that is funny. Imagine if that's your job, the pube airbrusher.
So I think originally, so when the Nostromo blows up and she gets onto the ship, I think that's where the movie was originally meant to end.
Oh.
And then I think they went back and shot that whole bit on the shuttle where, you know, the alien gets, you know, like typical horror movie style, the alien gets one last kind of hurrah, you know, one last battle. And to be honest with you, I think it was totally worth it because I thought that last bit on the climax on the shuttle was fantastic. Like, and I think the reason the alien doesn't actually try to attack Sigourney Weaver immediately on the shuttle is because the alien apparently went onto the shuttle just to find somewhere quiet to die.
Oh. Yeah, because I was wondering that. Because it's usually really bloodthirsty. And it's just like, boom, done.
Yeah, because that was something that I must have missed the first few times I watched the film. Because, you know, like, literally, 1 minute, the alien busts out of the chest and it's a tiny baby.
Yeah.
Within, you know, I don't know, a couple of hours of the movie, it's like a fully grown alien.
Yeah.
But I think there's some kind of accelerated growth and then it kind of accelerated its way to death almost. Because apparently you see the color of the alien change as well.
Yeah, it gets darker. Well, they wouldn't make a very good weapon then, would it? Which is the whole point. Because it would just grow up and die in like 24 hours or however long it took.
Unless they wanted to put it in stasis somehow.
What, so, I have a question because you have seen the other ones. And I know obviously the alien comes back. It doesn't die, right? At the end of that one?
Oh, no, I think this one... Oh, gosh, now you're asking a good question. No, I think in Alien 2... Have you seen Alien 2?
No.
Aliens?
No.
So in Aliens... It's a good sequel, by the way, if you do get a chance to watch it. It's not, they drop the horror element altogether. It's more of a science fiction action film. And so basically Sigourney Weaver's character is picked up by the corporation that owns the mining vessel that they, the Nostromo.
Oh, yeah. Whatever, yeah.
I think I might be butchering some of this, but, and I think she obviously tells them this is what happened.
Yeah.
You know, we lost her career. And I think the company doesn't necessarily believe her. And I think they take like a group of marines or something over back to wherever whichever planet it was so they could go and investigate or something. But then again, I think the corporation has a hidden agenda where they want
to get it.
Yeah, it's something
so it's a different one to the one that was on.
Oh gosh, yeah. Oh no. In the second one is there's a planet full of them, like there's loads of aliens.
Oh.
And you meet the alien queen and all that stuff.
Oh,
and,
what?
It's very good, yeah.
That makes sense. Because I thought, because I wrote a note and I was like, there is no way that alien survived. Because
Because
its death is very final. Like, how are they ever going to get this back? But now I understand.
So Aliens is directed by James Cameron, who did like T2 Terminator 2 and Titanic and Avatar and all that.
Okay, so you can see where the film goes from a horror more to, I guess, action sci-fi route.
Definitely. It's like a little mini war film almost. Yeah, it's very good. But it retains, unlike the other Alien films, it still retains like its own visual identity and it still feels grounded and real. Like, it's not like this kind of over-the-top thing. So, like, it's very much in line. It shares more DNA with Alien than it does with any of its sequels in terms of just the realisticness. Yeah. It's still very believable. Like, if you just watched Alien 1 and 2 and that was the series, like, you'd still walk away happy.
Yeah. I mean, and I guess when you've got such an iconic character like the Alien, I think we need to talk about the Alien itself because it's just so cool. I don't know what it is about it. Is that what it's called? Xenomorph. Yeah. It is so cool. Whoever came up with the fully grown version of it with that long head and it's kind of, it almost looks like it's wearing armor and it's going into battle. It's so insidious and just every single part about it, its tail, its like legs, everything makes it so scary and so it feels impossible to kill because it's deadly. It's, you know, it just, it's brilliant.
The artist, I think his name is H.R. Giger or something. H.R. Giger, Geiger, could be wrong there. But I think that's kind of his thing. Like, I think they got him in especially to design it because that's kind of like, I think he's responsible for the whole visual style and all the alien landscapes and all the alien.
I mean, props to him because I feel like it could have gone a completely different way if either the alien was too gimmicky or if it was too close to a human or if it was too far away from a human. You know, like it has to have some elements of being able to recognize it as a threat. Because if it was too far removed, it's almost like, well, I'm not sure what's intimidating about it. It's scary because it might kill you, but what's intimidating? Like, what's it making me feel? Whereas this is just enough humanoid to really get into your bones.
to think that the alien is only in this movie for 4 minutes.
Is it really?
It's like a just under 2 hour movie and he's only in there for 4 minutes and left, you know, the alien leaves that much of an impression.
Yeah. And I think that's why it was scary. And this is why it's a horror film is because, as we've always said, the fear of the unknown is a lot worse than the thing itself. And so it makes sense for it to only be there for 4 minutes because the whole point is building that tension and making you think it's going to be around every corner. And especially when Sigourney Weaver's character is trying to convince everyone that it's a real threat. And, you know, it elevates the status of it being a horror film for those reasons. I think if there was too much alien, it would get a bit same after a while because you're like, well, you're just going to kill every person. And that's why I think most of the good slasher films are good when you don't see the killer. You know, you don't know anything about them. All you know is that, you know, they've got a knife and they're somewhere in the town.
It also in line with other horror films that were good horror films is with, you know, even if the villain is only in there for like, you know, 1% of the film's runtime, I feel like we actually care about the crew in this movie. So you get to know the crew, you know, each one of them has like an identity. So they don't all just blur into one character. And because, I mean, I liked the characters in this. So I was totally happy to root for them. And when Ian Holm's character, you know, starts being a bit shady, when Ash starts getting shady, you know, I was rooting against him. You know, it's like all the bits they wanted me to feel something, you know.
Yeah.
I was suckered in at each one of those moments.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I mean, we've watched movies in the past where you just don't care about the hero.
Yeah. It's like, okay, they almost died 15 times. Okay, fine. But this one, you're like, stay alive. Don't die. And you know what's going to come. But...
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And touching upon something you said earlier on, like with the alien, I don't know if this is true or not, but when they were writing it, I think they wanted to find a way where they couldn't just kill off the alien immediately. So they didn't want to the crew just to come out and just shoot it and just, you know.
Yeah.
So they wanted the alien to be something that the crew struggled to kill but couldn't just kill outright. But it was possible to kill if...
Yeah.
I think how they got skirted around the, you know, just shooting it to smithereens bit was the acid blood.
Yeah.
So they, you know, because even, you know, how they demonstrate how a small drop of that acid blood would just go through the hull of the ship and, you know, each of the floors and everything. So if you shoot it to pieces, that
it's
ship would have
acid
just,
everywhere.
Yeah, it would have just blown itself up or something, you know, because the moment you let the oxygen out of the ship because of the acid blood, it's game over for all of them. So I think that's how they kind of balanced out the through not using guns on it or something.
That makes sense. I mean, I never really questioned it, to be honest. I would have normally, but I think I was just so into it that, you know, I didn't mind. I mean, that you do get slightly frustrated when there are scenes that it feels like they could have got him in that scene. You're like, you're so close. But it would have been a really short film if they got him the first time. So I get why they're doing it. But, you know, sometimes you're like, just take a flamethrower and just go for it. Just go everywhere. It doesn't matter what happens. Like, as long as the ship's still standing by the end, you'll be fine.
I think there were moments where the crew wanted to go for it, but then Ash kept doing something stupid that kind of stopped.
Yeah.
I just couldn't get over the how real, I mean, let alone, I mean, put the alien to the side, but you know, the face huggers.
Yeah.
Like, I just could not get over how realistic they looked, because I was looking at the skin and they were like subtly breathing, and the way the legs were moving and the tail was wrapping around Kane's neck, and I think mixed in with the sound of, like, each time that tail moved, it sounded like a rattlesnake or a snake.
Yeah.
And just everything about it just looked so damn realistic. And I was thinking, gosh, it's like you could bite into it or something. Yeah. Like, it was that realistic. It's just, I just thought it was phenomenal.
That's a really good indicator of body horror, which is that kind of using things that are fleshy and humanoid and makes you want to touch it and bite it and do all of these things to it. And it really freaks you out because of that. And I think they do this really well, because the face sucker is like fleshy and looks very, what's the word? Organic as a thing. And as the alien grows, it becomes less like that. It becomes more metallic, doesn't it? Because it gets darker and darker. And then it seems almost to have wires coming off it and stuff. So it turns from this organic being to a machine that you have to
get
past. And it's just a really cool evolution of the enemy in the film. I think it's just awesome.
Yeah. This is one of these kind of an anomaly of a movie, where normally in horror movies or whatever, you know, sometimes characters can be in a high stress situation and they just end up doing really stupid, making really stupid decisions. And I think this film, to a degree, had that as well. But at no point did I feel like the decisions the characters made were just ridiculously dumb. It all felt to me like, okay, they've been in space together for a long time. They're probably a little stressed out and a little wired and whatnot. But I think the bit which kind of exemplifies their kind of just decision-making in the film, to me, is, okay, so the face hugger has bled acid blood. So they're aware that this happens, that it's dangerous. And at this point, when they're cutting the face hugger or whatever, you know, Ian Holm and the other guy, I forget who it was, you know, they're wearing like face masks, goggles and whatnot. Later on in the film, when the face hugger dies, they put it on the table. They're not wearing any equipment, and they're there right up close to it, cutting it, dissecting it. And I'm like thinking, did you not learn from what just happened a minute ago? And I think that was the only bit in the film where I felt kind of like,
come on, guys. And also, I mean, realistically, what could any of that PPE helped with? But you are right, I forgot about that bit.
That's what it is. Yeah, maybe it wouldn't have helped. Yeah,
you're right. Yeah, at that point it wouldn't. But I do, there were scenes probably close to the beginning where we know what's going to happen and we know how dangerous it is, and they don't know how dangerous it is. So some of the stuff that they do seems really stupid. But actually, if you were in that situation and it was the first time you'd come across it, I mean, I would have sided with Sigourney Weaver and just be like, put that guy in the airlock. But if it was me, let's say, maybe it's an easy answer, but if we were on a spaceship together and I was like, please let me in, please let me in, I don't want to be out here, you'd have to be so rational, because we know each other, whereas they knew each other. And so you'd have to make that decision, like, I have to essentially kill my friend. And that would be really hard. Would you do it?
Because I think Ash is the one who unlocks the door and lets them in. Oh, gosh. Yeah. In my head, I'd like to think, I could say to you, no, sorry, this is protocol. You're gonna have to stay in the airlock. But then there's that emotional part of you that thinks, no, I can't let her die.
Yeah, and also you don't know what's happening next, whereas we do when we're watching the film. So they genuinely don't know if this is a bad thing or not.
They
don't really know what happened. So I suppose it's...
Well, they do have a guy. Well, Kane does have like an alien in his
structure space. Yeah, I suppose they could have made a bit more decision. But yeah, I mean the body horror part of this, where like obviously that iconic bit where the stomach explodes and the thing comes out. I mean, it's just brilliant. I'm waiting for it for the whole film. Like, ooh, it's gonna happen. And every time I'm like, yes.
That whole sequence is one of the best shot and acted sequences in cinema history. Like, if there was like a top 100 scenes in cinema history, that chest burster scene is.
It made me feel really sick. Like, I just felt really gross because, well, I knew what was coming, but the acting is brilliant and their reactions are great and it just feels so real.
So I think the rumor was they shot it in one take, but apparently that isn't the case, that they shot it twice. And the first time round, the chest burster thing didn't work.
Oh.
But what they did was, I think, is they ended up using that unused, that take where it didn't work, and giving the illusion that the chest burster is not succeeding to come out of his chest, made it look even more horrific. It's like this chest burster is trying to force its way out. So they used the bad take and mixed it in with the good take to make it look.
Oh, yeah, because it kind of pushes, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And then bursts through. Again, it's just... And it's that mixture of, for the first part of the film, the horror is all about that gross, horrible body stuff. And then it moves on from that. Like, it finishes that part of it and turns into a more of a slasher film, you know, picking you off one by one. I mean, to be fair, there are gory scenes throughout. Like, quite a lot of the deaths are gory. But some of them are so quick that you kind of don't really...
There was one I wasn't happy with. And you'll have to remind me if I'm just forgetting something. But you know when the alien killed... Oh, gosh, what's the other woman's name? Lambert.
Yeah.
The alien kills Lambert, the other woman. That isn't Sigourney Weaver. But that death kind of... You don't really see what happens. It's just that the alien kind of... You just see its tail kind of go in between her legs or go up her back or something.
Yeah.
And that's it. It just cuts and you just assume she's dead. But
yeah, I don't really know what they did with that. Maybe it was to balance it out so that it's not just so formulaic that you see everything all the time.
Yeah.
I don't know why they would do it. I mean, her character was slightly annoying because she was a bit like, you know, she didn't do much to help, I don't think. I feel like a lot of her character was like, oh my God, panic, 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 which I would have been. I'm not saying I would have been any better than that, but, you know, you're like, come on.
Yeah. Yeah. I think what I'd like to see with this movie is, and I just kept thinking it all the way through, is, don't get me wrong, I think Alien is a near perfect movie, but what I'd love to see is, knowing all the kind of science we know now and how, you know, what our kind of theories about other planets or alien life or whatever, you know, the way things behave in space and all that, and I'd love to see this film get a remake, but I'd want them to do it if it was ultra scientific and ultra realistic
and not using CGI, that you have to use props, you can't make it, because that is exactly what would happen.
That goes without saying. Yeah
because I saw it, and I think what the reason why I'm remembering it is because I watched a episode of Doctor Who. I haven't seen Doctor Who for years, but it was Christmas and they did a special.
Okay.
And I watched it, and the CGI was so terrible. I mean, it wasn't terrible CGI, it was just so much of it.
Yeah.
And they were in a spaceship, and the whole thing was in the spaceship, and I could see them in the green room. Like, I could see it the green screen. I mean, you couldn't physically, but you could see that they were just in a room, and how boring that is for them and for you and all this stuff. And it's like, that story was really cool. Like, the storyline was great, but then it was just taken over by the amount of CGI. And at that point, you're just watching like an advert for something, you know, the really high level stuff. It's not worth it. But yes, it would be really cool to see a remake with a bit more of, I think it would probably be more of a commentary maybe on the human civilization at the time, because that was a really interesting part of the film that they don't go into a lot, which is Ash's reason for being there was to get a weapon back to Earth, why was he trying to get a weapon back to Earth? I mean, maybe the second one talks about it, but like a bit more of the intrigue as to why, what the politics are behind these space enterprises and stuff like that. And I wonder if a film that was done today would do something with that.
Yeah, I found that whole thing quite interesting with Ash, because obviously the first time you watch the movie, you don't immediately realize that Ash is a bloody android and he's the villain of this story. He's the one who actually eggs the team on. He's the, you know, to go visit this planet, because he's like, well, you know the protocol, if we find another life form, we got to go investigate it. Oh, well, you know, if you don't go, you're going to forfeit all of your payment for this mission if you don't go and do it. Or, you know, so he's the one who drops these little hint bombs everywhere, which make the team who don't want to go explore, you know, he's the one who steers them in that direction. And yeah, it's only the second time around when watching it where I was like, oh, wow, this is really subtle and really, really clever. Because it's like all the motivation and the reason why they're doing this is just dropped there in black and white, but it's so little attention is drawn to it. So the viewer gets all the information, but they're not bombarded with it.
Yeah, and it doesn't over-explain things to a point where it becomes a different film. Because we have seen a few films where the plot is overtaken by subtext or by things that aren't strictly relevant to the horror part of the film. And so it ends up being less of a horror film, more of a commentary on something. And you think, okay, it's fine to have those elements in it, but it has to work with it. It can't take away from the main point of this film. And realistically, Alien is a very basic film. Like you said at the beginning, you could explain the plot in less than 20 seconds. But there are so many elements of it that make it unique. Of all the ones that we've said, and I think Sumptuous works in all parts of it. You know, it's just one of those films that's iconic for a reason, and it deserves its iconic status.